I sent this to Jesse, so he's gonna put it up on Learning Suite for the camera's sake. Okay, so I think speaker meeting and word meeting is fairly straightforward. That's interestingly, it's the first concept that we often teach, and it's also something that people find incredibly useful when they write their research papers. People really like that distinction. So I'm assuming it's fairly unproblematic. What would you, if you had to describe to somebody who's never taken this course but is basically a smart person, what the difference is, how would you describe the difference between speaker meeting and word meeting, or speaker meeting and sentence meeting?
So speaker meaning, or I guess starting with word meaning, word meaning is what is implied from the word itself, or what the word entails.
Okay.
And the speaker meaning can be interpreted based on different tone or context or situation. Mm-hmm. Just depending on who says it, the speaker meaning can vary.
Yeah, good. So does anyone else need the stapler? So another way of saying the difference, does anybody else want to give their take on the difference between speaker and word meaning?
And my last class audition, I had help from example for something with this, just to explain what pragmatics, just to explain a little bit about pragmatics and everything about how, like, what people can, what the words directly mean altogether can mean a different thing than, like, just the words on their own. And so I pulled up a quote from Julius Caesar where it's when Cassius is trying to convince Brutus to betray Caesar, and it sounds like he's just like, oh, you're so awesome, you don't know how much you're worth, you don't know, like, Caesar can't even see how much you're worth, and all of Rome loves you. And then Brutus kind of responds like, wait, what are you trying to get me to do now? What he really meant by that wasn't just a blot, but he's like, what the word just is like, oh yeah, he's giving a compliment. But what he's really trying to say is, you should totally help me out by stabbing Caesar in the back, literally. That's what he's, the point he's trying to get across is to get him to side with it, is to try to, his meaning is to try to get him thinking against.
That's a very complicated example, actually. What we're going to talk about, the kinds of things we're talking about right now with that example later on in the course. But it's a really simple, I mean, it's a good example, but it's a little bit more complicated than you need to get. So, you know, one good way to think of the difference is word meaning is anything you would find in a dictionary. Speaker meaning is what you wouldn't want to put in the dictionary because it has to do with the context in which the contextual factors that make meaning more subtle and more nuanced. Okay. Okay. The difference between utterance, a sentence, and a proposition, is everybody pretty clear on that one? Yeah. What are they? What are the differences? See, when you say things in your own words, then that's really empowering, and that's the test of when you really know the concepts.
Well, utterance can be literally anything. It doesn't have to be grammatical. A sentence doesn't mean, like, necessarily be grammatical, but it's never, like, once you say a sentence, it becomes an utterance, not necessarily just a sentence. This is what I understood from, is that?
An utterance can be anything.
Oh.
Is this an utterance?
Any speech.
Okay. Any act of speaking, you know, sound waves moving through the air is an utterance, right? A sentence is an abstract idea that is something that is principled, and it's like a blueprint for an utterance, and the blueprint depends upon the rules of a particular language. Okay? I know that that's but then a proposition, we've been dealing with propositions because we've been doing propositional notation on the board. Proposition is something even more abstract from a sentence, which means it is the basic bare bones skeletal meaning of a thought, right? That would typically be uttered as a declarative sentence. Okay. So that would be a proposition. Okay. And remember the typographical conventions we're using to represent the differences. So utterances, single quotes, sentences, italics, propositions in special notation. Okay. Um, Okay, yeah, there's a chart on page 23 that it would be a bad idea to look over. What about sense, reference, and referent? And then variable and fixed referent. Sense, reference, and referent. The easy one is probably referent, right? Why? Why was it easy? It's a real world thing of whatever is being referred to. Not necessarily a physical object, could be like something like conceptual, like a unicorn, but often it's a physical object. Yeah. So that's easy, referent. What about sense? What is sense another word for? What is sense another word for? Basic meaning, right? What's the sense of that word? What's the basic meaning of that word? And then reference would be what? Anytime you refer, it is an act of reference. Okay? What would be a good example of referring?
This book.
That camera. That table. This room. This class, right? Okay. So we just gave examples of, what about variable versus fixed? A variable versus a fixed reference. We did that as a homework.
So a fixed reference is something that always stays the same. Like the moon is always going to be that certain moon that we're talking about. But like, your my best friends could be someone else tomorrow.
Right.
Very good. That's true, especially with teenagers. Teenagers change their best friends like we change clothes. Good examples. Okay, what would be an example of an equative sentence? Nice. The Commander-in-Chief is the President of the United States. The President of the United States is the leader of the Republican Party.
Jimmy Fallon is the host of The Tonight Show.
Yeah, good. And that's not something that will always be true, right? Who are past hosts of The Tonight Show?
Jay Leno.
Even before Jay Leno.
That's
before your time. <Yeah. laughs> You guys, Johnny Carson.
Okay, I knew that. Deep down,
you knew that somewhere. Okay, good. Other examples of equative sentences? What's the difference between an equative sentence and a sentence that has an identity predicate?
An equative sentence can go both ways.
So you're saying the referring expressions can be switched?
Can be switched, yeah.
Yeah. So Atlanta is the most congested city in Georgia. The most congested city in Georgia is Atlanta. That's a good example of the switcheroo property for equatives. It doesn't always work. Occasionally it doesn't work, but it's a good litmus test. It's a good, mostly true test.
But then like something like Donald is a duck doesn't work the other way around. Like, a duck is Donald.
Right, and furthermore, Donald is a duck is not an equative sentence. Why?
Because it's
a duck. A duck, right? He's not the only duck, right? Donald is the duck. Well, that's a weird sentence, isn't it? Let's say that you want to say, what would be an example of a person who once had a different name?
Names? Would that work?
Prince.
Snoop Dogg, who changed his name to Snoop Lion.
Say that again.
Snoop Dogg changed his name to Snoop Lion. Change it back to Snoop Dogg.
What was his ordinary name that his parents gave him before they realized he was going to be famous?
Oh, I don't know.
Thomas. Jay-Z's real name is Sean Carter.
Jay-Z is Sean Carter.
You guys know so much about these people.
What about, what's her name's real name? Pink, what's her real name?
Alicia Moore.
Alicia Moore is Pink. I'm so impressed.
I have one talent in this life, and it's to remember every celebrity fact ever. That's my one thing that I've got going for.
Snoop Dogg's real name is Calvin Cordozar Broivis Jr.
But let's take a simple example. Okay, so Superman.
Let's go with Wonder Woman.
Well, I already started writing it, so we'll just leave it like Superman is Clark Kent. What's the difference between saying this and saying, Atlanta? There's a more kind of essential relationship between these two, which is why we say they're identical. But equative sentences and identity predicates, sentences that have an identity predicate, you could say they're sisters or brothers. I mean, they're species of the same kind of thought. You're equating one thing with another. It's just that when we use logical notation, we use an equal sign. That's really the main difference.
Yeah, if we were to write the top one and top of the show in the patient, would we still use an equal sign, even though it's...
Well, I can easily fend off your question, although it's a good one, because the book tells us we can't do anything except use proper names in logical notation. Mm-hmm. So we don't know how to do this yet. And as far as I'm concerned, we never will. You guys might. I never will, because it's not the sort of thing that that I'm all that interested in. But if we did know how to write this in logical notation, yes, we would use it.
Okay.
Yeah. So, is everybody clear on that?
Yeah.
This is just the logical notational way of expressing equativeness.
Yeah.
So. Okay. So, a predicate or a predicator. What's the relationship between predicates and recurring expressions, or predicators and recurring expressions? Yeah.
Predicators are things that are not the recurring expressions.
That's right. That's a good way to say it,
right?
They're in if you guys have had phonology before in any of your previous classes, you could say they're in complementary distribution, right? There's one and then there's the other, and they're never going to be the same thing. And they're like two essential ingredients for meaning, for expressing meaning. You've got to have a referring expression, and you've got to have a predicator to express propositional truth. Okay, so propositional truth is a special subject matter of this half of the class. We're going to get into more interesting kinds of meanings when we get into pragmatics. But for now, we're focusing on only the most formalizable way of approaching meaning, and that is expressing declarative statements in propositional truth. And to do that, you need a referring expression and a predicate. Okay. So how do you identify what's what? You basically do it through a process of elimination, right? So if I gave you, the exam is going to be, did Jesse already tell you, those of you who went yesterday, did he tell you what the exam will be like? It's just going to be multiple choice questions and an extra credit question at the end. But essentially, you would be asked to pick out what would be the referring expressions in a particular sentence. What would be the predicate? So you would be asked questions like that. So be sure you can do those. Does anyone have any questions about that procedure? Is it fairly straightforward? Usually that part of the test goes really well, but every once in a while somebody gets tripped up, so don't let yourself get tripped up. Okay? Alexi, are you okay on that? Yeah? Okay, good. What about the difference between a one and a two place predicate?
So is that how, like, some words have to have two parts? Like, if you're saying under, it has to be under, like, then the book gives, like, the example of, like, X is under Y, and Y is under X.
Great example. So the predicator under would be a two-place predicate, because it implies that there have to be two arguments, right? X has to be under. Something has to be under something else. It's an inherently relational predicate. What would be an example of a one place predicate?
Sleep.
John sleeps. Yeah, you're predicating something about John. That is, that he sleeps. And sleeping doesn't need to take more than one argument, right? Now, occasionally you get deviant uses. I've noticed that a lot of verbs that I think of as intransitive verbs are used transitively in English. Like the verb game, or the word game, right? That's a predicate. X is a game. You know, Scrabble is a game. But I'm reading, you know, about people gaming the system.
Yeah.
I think that means they're getting away with stuff, but I'm not sure. Another example would be, what was the predicator we were just talking about? Sleep, yeah. This room sleeps five people, right? So inherently it means five people can sleep in this room. But it's still kind of being used as a transitive verb. But I would analyze that one as a one-place predicate, even though it can be used in that weird kind of figurative way. You often get those kinds of usages among people who are specialists in, like, hotel hospitality, right? They develop almost their own register of speaking. This room sleeps five, this room sleeps two. But most regular people who don't have to worry about hotel logistics would probably not use that term. But that's what happens, right?
Yeah. Would we say, like, if something can be used as one-place predicate verb, but in a different context it could be used as a two-place predicate verb, like, those two versions of sleep have different definitions, so they would be different words. So the sleep, that means to actually sleep, like a person to be sleeping, like that first person kind of thing. Right. That would be always a one place verb. A one place,
right.
Yeah, one. That would always have just one place, one predicate, right?
Right. And it's inherently, I doubt very seriously that the metaphorical meaning, this room sleeps by people, was first, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a sort of that's parasitic upon the basic usage, which is I sleep, or
so
John sleeps.
Kind of on a different word. So it's different, you can almost separate them.
It depends on how you want to analyze it. You could say it's a different word because it's a transitive verb, or you could simply say it's a figurative usage
mm-hmm.
of the predicate sleep, right? Yeah. Other questions? What about a predicate like lend? How many places would that be?
Two or three.
Right. I think it would have to be three, but it might only be, you might only express two. You might say John lends money, right? That's what he does for a living. But ultimately, he's always lending money to somebody. So ultimately, it's a three-place predicate, right? Other examples of three-place predicates?
Give.
Put. It's a good one.
Yeah.
I put the handouts on the table. All right. Okay, generic sentences. Are you all clear on what generics are? All right. What would be an example of a generic? That's a good one. I like that. It's nice and simple, right? Pithy. Dogs bark. Yeah. And what makes that such a good example of a generic? Dogs bark.
They apply to all dogs.
It's not referring to any particular dog. It doesn't really have a referring expression. It applies to a whole unrestricted class of individuals. Nice. Yeah. Other examples that might even... Remember we talked about other kinds of generic sentences that are not, they don't maybe sound very scientific-y, but they still express general truths. Yeah.
You know, ducks lay eggs,
Yeah. So that's a good example of how generics can be true or false, right? Because they don't necessarily apply to every single duck. They're making a generalization, a generalizable truth, right? Which could be true or false with regard to specific ducks. Yeah, very good. Remember, yeah, Jared.
So if we said something like BYU students follow an honor code, is that too specific to be generic? Because we're talking about this unique class of students, BYU students, but BYU students itself is still very broad.
Yeah, that's kind of a gray area. You're right, you're not referring to, you are referring to an unrestricted class of individuals, but you're at the same time you're naming them with a specific proper name that belongs to a formal institution. So I would say it's not the best example of a generic sentence. Generics really should not have any referring expressions in them. And you could argue that BYU students is a referring expression because it's got a proper name. I agree with you, it's an unrestricted class of individuals, but it does have that proper name. So that was just a little bit problematic. Other examples, yeah.
But, like, if I said, like, Americans or something, that's still a proper name that refers to, but it still refers to a really large group.
Yeah, and I would say that's like the BYU example.
Because we used, when we were talking about the generic sentences, we did use some nationality ones.
We did.
British drink tea.
All British people drink tea.
I'm sure that all the British drink tea.
Were those in my PowerPoints? I don't think they were.
Oh, I thought we talked about some.
Were they in the book?
Stereotypes.
That sounds like stereotypes. Wait, let me see if the book mentioned anything that had proper. Generic. Generic is a sentence in which some statement is made about a whole unrestricted class of individuals as opposed to any particular individual. The whale is a mammal. Gentlemen prefer blondes. A sexist sentence. A male of the species guards the eggs. A wasp makes its nest in a hole in a tree. A wasp just stuck in there. Jasper is a twit is an example of not generic, because I think Jasper is a twit. They say no about that one, yeah. Our basic and very safe definition. Yes. Yeah, they don't really have anything in here that has a proper name. So I would steer away from proper names with generics. Yeah. But I agree that proper names are appropriate when you're talking about stereotypes. Indian English speakers pronounce their W's like B's. You know, that would be making a general statement, but you're still referring to a group of people.
Yeah. So if I don't say British people, if I say people that live in Britain drink a lot of tea, would that be different then? But it's like Indian English speakers is still a referring expression.
You have to remember what the purpose of generics is. You're either expressing, and this is where we get into ideas of fuzzy categories, because we're not saying that everything either is or is not a generic statement. We're saying there are really good examples of generics and there are less good examples of generics, right? Everything is a fuzzy category. So a really good example of a generic would be a sentence that makes a statement about a general truth and it has a law-like character. So when you say British people drink tea, that sounds like an observation, and it doesn't really sound like, you know, it sounds like you're talking about something as a custom or a fashion rather than a law-like property. You can extend generics also into proverbial statements, right? And those express kind of moral laws, right? Like the fruit doesn't fall far from its tree, right? You can tell what kind of person you're dealing with by where that person came from. So the ideal generic or the ideal proverbial statement would express a law-like kind of truth or a moral kind of truth. Probabilistic truths. Okay. What would be some examples of from your book? Okay, the male of the species guards the eggs, right? Mosquitoes carry the West Nile virus. You could imagine in a kind of a scientific discourse context that those would be examples that you would hear, right? Okay, so unit 7, deixis and definiteness, right? So deixis is, what is deixis? It's a special property of a lot of words in language that are used quite a bit by speakers. A special property of deixis is that
the word changes meaning based on the speaker.
The word changes meaning based on the situation of speaking, often involving the speaker identity. Yeah. So my mother means something when I say it. You guys say it, it means a totally different individual. My is the deictic term, right? My, this, that, his, hers. Lots and lots of deixis in language, right? And that's deixis is often what helps us make definite referring expressions. That trash can. This carpet, right? And so it's hard to understand exactly what people are referring to when they use deixis unless you're in the same speech situation as they are. Right? Because deictic terms are shifters. They shift reference with situation. Okay. Okay, let's see. What is an extension? Well, I already explained that. So, why do we even talk about extensions? Could you ever actually point to an extension in the world? What is it? It's convenient fiction, let us say. We assume that something like an extension exists because we know that people are capable of using words in mostly appropriate ways, right? And so the extension is suggested as an explanation for that, right? It's a hypothetical set of everything that a word could refer to in the world or in the universe of discourse. So, and it has to do with past as well as future and present examples. So the word horse, the extension for that word, all the horses in the past, all the horses in the present, all the horses in the future that could ever be referred to with that word horse. It's a very weird and hard to fathom concept. I think we did several of these kinds of diagrams. I want to make sure that you're not confused about these concepts. So let's say this is an extension, okay? And then you might want to have maybe some fuzziness along the edges to indicate that there might be some peripheral cases of horsiness, okay? And then we talked about a really good example of a horse. And I'm not really a horse person, but which means I don't know very much about them. But I know there are different kinds of horses. Does anybody know anything about horses? Name an example of a horse that you would consider to be a prototypical course?
Appaloosa?
Or not really, no.
Appaloosa's a little.
No, I would say thoroughbreds are